Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we're going to get back to our Venom Versus episodes that I want to do. I have three left. The first one here, what we're going to do today is his rematch with Darkhawk, which took place in the pages of Darkhawk number 35, 36, and 37. So this was like a three-part story called Operation Symbiote. Of course, like everything that Danny Fingeroth did with this book, because he was the writer and then Todd Smith was the artist. And what they wanted to do was, still keep the storyline from Darkhawk going and just integrate, the Venom story as well. So what they did was they found a way to bring back Darkhawk's father. You know, we thought he died like in issue like 29 or something like that. Last time, Venom fought him, and sometime in between then and now, it was presumed that he was dead, but he was kind of in a coma or, pretending to be unconscious or something. And so he's in the hospital from, and the bad guys are watching over him in this one. But then also Bazin, like that crime lord that his father made a deal with, he is still alive. That we find out in this run here that he's still alive and he's being kept in a coma also by the bad guys. And they're using that to basically, bait Darkhawk's father and be like, hey, look, this is what happened to him. We kept him alive. He can't think, he can't see, he doesn't understand what's going on. He's basically brain dead, which is a fate way worse than death. And if you don't do what we say, it's going to happen to you as well. So that's what they're kind of doing in these issues, is like someone who's worked, who Bazin worked for. It's like the crime lords just keep piling up and, you keep going up the ladder, and they're revealing, villains here in this one. And so while Darkhawk is, kind of trying to understand his amulet in this storyline, because what's happening is he's starting to stay as Darkhawk longer. So whenever he activates the amulet and he becomes Darkhawk, it's harder and harder to turn back into Chris, Chris Powell, his human form. And he's struggling with it. And he wants to keep telling his family that he's okay, that he's alive, and that he's not, didn't get killed with his father, and that maybe their father's still alive. And he wants to bring them hope. But every time he is in a situation where he can go talk to them, the suit won't work. It won't turn him back into Chris. And as he's, progressing and doing more superhero stuff, he's becoming more and more Darkhawk and less Chris. His mind is still in there. He can still fight with his mind and take control, but it's just harder and harder to gain control of this very powerful amulet. And then when the story starts, there's this guy named Broad, and it's like picking up, a thread that's left over from previous storylines where Broad wants to get revenge on Chris and his family. And so he gets, finds out where Chris is, and he has this little kid who is friends with Chris and their family, tries to get, him, a little kid, to kill Chris and his family. So it starts off on a very dark note. It's a, it deals with kids, with guns and things like that. And that's kind of like the beginning of how this story, starts, I guess. And this is Broad here, and this is him befriending the kid and being like, hey, we've been friends for a while now, so now I want you to do something. I want you to get revenge on Chris for not caring about you, about his younger brother, about, the mother, their mother and your mother. And we're going to go after them and take our revenge on Chris. And so that's kind of the story that starts off there. I don't know too much about it because I haven't read the issues in between these, but it does end on an emotional note with the little kid aiming the gun at the bad guy, at Broad, but then end up not pulling the trigger, and it becomes a situation where Chris almost reveals a secret identity to save his family, but then he just decides to, jump in as Chris and save them. And luckily he does. He's able to knock the gun away, and then a knife gets pulled, and he's able to, beat up Broad, because obviously he's a crime fighter too, and Broad wasn't expecting that. So when he knocks him out, they leave him for the cops, and then he finds out the woman that's been helping his mom, she knew about this guy being dangerous, and she didn't say anything, so they turn her and Broad over to the authorities. And then from there, Chris finds out that he has to go to San Francisco. His father may still be alive, and it looks like he might be in San Francisco. He woke up out of his bed, he left them a message, and he's like, look, I'm in San Francisco, please come get me. It looks like I'm at, I can see the street signs, they're this and this, and then he goes back and pretends like he's back in his coma or whatever. But the bad guys are on to him, so they know, he sent out a distress call, but all that makes them want to do is up their plans. They're like, all right, look, someone might come look for him now, but let's, continue with our plans, and we'll keep an eye on him, and he's still, under our house, under our control, so we're not too worried. Meanwhile, there's a group out there in San Francisco that's trying to kill Venom. They're working on some kind of elaborate plan to kill Venom, and Venom gets wind of this, so that's how he gets into the story. While Darkhawk is flying from, the East Coast all the way over to San Francisco. So it shows him actually stopping in like Chicago, and he has to rest, and he has to hit the amulet, turn back into Chris, and then, take a breather. And then when he hits the amulet back again, he's back to full strength. So while Venom's getting answers, you know, to figure out who's, you know, after him and who's hunting him, Darkhawk, like I said, is taking these breaks in major cities. And so it took him like an hour to get, I think, from New York or New Jersey or wherever he was over to, you know, Chicago. And then it's going to take him another 45 minutes, as it says, to get to San Francisco. So yeah, that's how kind of, I guess, the amulet works. When he's able to power down, you know, he's fine. You know, the suit kind of takes all the energy and power for itself and, you know, takes all the strain. So he has to power down the suit, and that's the only reason it let him, because it was like, hey, the suit wants to be in control all the time, but it gets exhausted from time to time. So this time it's like, all right, fine, Chris, you can be human again, you know, for a minute. So he does, and then he's like, all right, well, now I'm in Chicago on a rooftop, I gotta get to California. So the suit knew I was in this situation, I'm gonna have to reactivate the suit and get over to San Francisco to help out and find my dad. So that's what he does. And so he heads into San Francisco, and he gets there about 45 minutes later and comes across Venom, and the two of them start fighting. And that's when Venom reveals to Darkhawk, hey, last time we fought, I pretended I was dead because I sent some goodness in you. But if you're not going to act good and you're going to fight me, then I'm totally going to take you down. And Darkhawk's like, yeah, I thought I killed you. And for weeks, I thought you were dead. And the guilt was tearing me apart until I saw somewhere on TV that you were still alive in New York fighting, you know, Venom or fighting Carnage and Spider-Man and stuff. He's like, so that was the only reason I'm over it now. He goes, but you're a killer and I need to put you down, but I'm going to try to bring you to the cops and the authorities. And Venom's like, yeah, good luck with that. So as they're fighting, all of a sudden they get hit with this, you know, sonic blast, and they both get knocked down. And Venom's like, wow, sonics, that's one of my few weaknesses. Who the hell, you know, did that? Who's in control of this, and who's attacking us? And you find out that it's the group, the Seekers, not named after me, and I'm not named after them, but I love that. That's like the group called the Seekers. Basically, each one, there's like Fireball and Thunder, Lightning, something, and then each one of them has like a power that could actually hurt Venom, and they're put together and hired to come hunt him down. So this was the thing Venom was on, you know, when he was looking for people who were putting together a plan to hurt him. This was that person's plan, and it turns out that person is also the same person that has Darkhawk's father, you know, under his control and, you know, under his house, you know, where Darkhawk's father is pretending to be hurt, but they're onto him. You know, the bad guys are onto him, and they're like, yeah, let him do what he thinks he's doing. Let's let him think he's in control here, but really we are, and we're not too worried about it. So next issue, Seek and Hide, which is issue 36 of Darkhawk. This is part two of Operation Symbiote, and it's basically more or less just a whole issue of them battling the Seekers. You have Fireball, Chain Lightning, Laserworks, and Sonic are the four members of the Seekers. And so each one of those powers could, you know, hurt Venom in a big way, especially when you get hit him with the sonic, hit him with the fireball, hit him with some lasers and that lightning, and he's pretty much dead. So they're going full force, and they're like, hey, Darkhawk, get out of here. We're not after you. We're after Venom. So just do, you know, get out of the way. And Darkhawk's like, look, he may be a bad guy, but I have a feeling you guys aren't much better. And if you're, you know, muscles for hire, chance are you've probably killed innocent people. So I'm not going to play this game. Venom deserves to be locked up, but I'm not going to let him get killed, you know. So Darkhawk's doing the superhero thing, obviously, even though he almost earlier killed that guy who turned a gun on his family. If it wasn't for his mother, he probably would have killed that guy. So yeah, he's still human for sure. And he has the capability of killing, and definitely it's in him to do so. But you know, when he thinks clearly, he tries to do the right thing. When he's not super emotional, especially when his family's not involved, because that's definitely the line that when people cross it, he goes full force. So Venom actually lets Darkhawk wear the symbiote, kind of. He covers him with it, kind of like how he did with Punisher and Funeral Pyre, where he used it as a shield. In this case, he's using it to do the camouflage powers so that they can both get away from the Seekers without the Seekers seeing them. But then, of course, when they do, you know, they get right back into fighting. Darkhawk's like, look, just because you brought me to the bridge here, you know, doesn't mean I'm going to let you go. You know, you're still the bad guy, and I'm going to take you down. And then over here, you have, this is where the actual bad guys are plotting, and that's Chris's father, Darkhawk's father, and he's strapped down. Now they're like, you've revealed to him, hey, we know you got out of your bed. We know you made a phone call. We're going to keep you under, and here's Bazin, and this, again, this is our threat. He's basically brain dead. If you want to be brain dead with them and never understand, when your family finally does find you, if you're not going to recognize them, you're not going to be able to speak to them. They're just going to see a shell of a man. If you want that to happen, then fine, let it be. But otherwise, help us. Tell us who your other contributors are, other people who were traitors to our cause. And he's like, I wasn't a traitor. You know, you guys are the traitors. We had ideals at one point and you guys betrayed them. And so, yeah, I had allies, but I'm never going to give them up. So he's, you know, basically being threatened to be tortured until he gives up that information. And meanwhile, these like a couple guys that Johnny and another guy that Darkhawk knew at one point and saved their lives one of them gets infected with something, and he turns into like a techno virus monster, almost like the Phalanx from the X-Men. And that's like a little side story that's been building up. I don't know too much about it, but I do know he breaks into Avengers headquarters to get the evil Darkhawk amulet. And he does grab that and take it for himself because he has a higher being he's serving now that he's this like, you know, robot figure, you know, techno virus guy. But he does break free from that mind control, and we'll get to that here in a second. But he does end up helping, Johnny does end up helping Darkhawk. So he doesn't fully turn on him. He does in the moment, and he, you know, breaks into Avengers Tower. The only downside is he breaks into Avengers Mansion and takes the amulet, but he takes it from Captain America, and Captain America is only seen for like two pages, and he gets beat up and punked out pretty much. And you're like, oh man, couldn't you put like a different Avenger there? I guess he was caught by surprise or something. But, you know, as a Cap fan, I'm like, ah, oh, come on, man. You got a punk Cap out. But yeah, I guess it happens to everybody. So Venom and, you know, Darkhawk continuing to fight. And then the Seekers show up again, and they start taking down Venom. And at this point, Darkhawk is out of energy. He has to turn back into Chris, but the suit's now not letting him because he wants to turn back into Chris and then save Venom. And the suit's like, look, just let them kill each other. You're here to find your father. If you want to turn back into Chris and repower and find your father, that's great. But otherwise, you know, we're staying out of this one. And he's, you know, hitting the amulet. Kind of, come on, we could do this. We can take them down, and we'll go get our dad. You know, we'll play the hero thing, and everything will work out. So just trust me on this one. And it does temporarily. It turns him into Chris, but then he immediately realizes, all right, I got to be Darkhawk once again. I have no choice. I'm up on this bridge. There's no way down. And also there's a fight going on, and I got to be a part of it. So he does, and he goes, you know, to jump into the battle. And meanwhile, his mom, who's now with the kids, you know, the kid with the gun from the beginning of the issue, and then their son and everything, she's all got them all together. They're sleeping. And now she decides, you know what, I better go to San Francisco. That's where my husband said he was. And I'm going to go try to track him down. I'm going to go to that address that he gave on our voicemail. So she leaves for San Francisco. And the battle back in San Francisco continues. They're fighting all night long with the Seekers and, you know, Darkhawk and Venom. And they end up getting a jump on the Seekers. They blast him away with his, you know, his amulet. He uses it to blast them away. And then as they go underwater, Venom grabs them and they swim to safety. They get to shore, and that's when Venom says, all right, last chance. You know, like, are you going to turn and fight me again? Or are you gonna team up with me and we can take down the Seekers and then these other bad guys that the Seekers work for? And at this point, Darkhawk doesn't know it involves his father yet. So he's like, no, I'm not going to do what my father did. He teamed up with Bazin way back when. And that's how he got into this mess, by making deals with questionable people. I'm not going to make a deal with you, Venom. So, no, we're going to fight now. And so, once again, they get into a fight. I think they fight like five times in these three issues. So this isn't even just round two. It's like round two through six, pretty much. Venom comes at him pretty big in the beginning of the next issue and the final issue. And this issue 37 of Darkhawk. And the battle continues. But then Venom is like, once again, shows mercy on Darkhawk. He's like, look, I pretended to be, you know, dead last time. Then when we fought earlier, I kind of let you get away, and I webbed you up. I'm going to web you up again. I really am trying to do everything I can to not kill you, kid. So just walk away now. And he's like, and I'm going to go find the Seekers, and I'm going to go find who they work for, and so on. So Venom disappears. And meanwhile, Darkhawk turns back into Chris. And he sees this letter that's inside of him. And it says, the era of the Darkhawks is over. I can no longer protect you or project you, I guess. Project you? Maybe that's projecting the suit onto him or something. I don't know. Do not use the amulet anymore, or your own death is assured. Or maybe project. I don't know. Maybe it should say protect, or maybe project is something from the lore of the book that I haven't, you know, caught on to. So if you know, let me know. Or maybe if it's typo, whatever. Doesn't matter. We get what he's saying. So basically, he can't turn into Darkhawk anymore because the next time could be his last time. And of course, his father's life is at stake now. And he's starting to piece all this stuff together. So he's like, all right, I gotta be Darkhawk again. And he's like, and yeah, that means my dad is not gonna know it's me when I save him. He's not gonna be able to see my face, but, you know, whatever. I gotta do it. I gotta go save him. So yeah, and this is the issue where you actually see his mom on a late night plane. She's flying into San Francisco. It's like, you know, gonna be turning into morning soon. And there's an FBI agent on the plane that's been in the book before. So I guess they're gonna like collaborate on, you know, on their I guess, way of attack, or how are they going to approach the situation when they get there, when they get to the address. She now has an FBI agent who's willing to help her out that she knew from before. So when they saw each other on the plane, they're like, hey, and I guess they talk and piece together their plan. And then they're like, hey, I have this address. Let's go there and start there and look for my husband. So even the mom, it has something to do. And she's like trying to, you know, play a part in saving her own husband as well. And then this is where Captain America gets punked out. The dark amulet gets taken away by the, the techno organic virus guy. And then Darkhawk powers up one more time to go into battle to save, his father, but also take down Venom and the Seekers. And that's what happens. They get into this big battle. They fight it out as usual. And Darkhawk does not compromise. He does not team up with Venom, even though Venom kind of wants to. And then Venom gets in, to the bad guy's lair, and he actually starts taking down some of the bad guys. He uses his symbiote. He's like, hey, you want my symbiote? Take it. And he starts using it to, like, tear the guy apart. And then Darkhawk, he, takes down the Seekers and then finds Venom. And he shows up, and he just starts walloping Venom. He's like, you know what? I'm tired of this. And he saw Venom near his father, too. And he's like, stay away from him. That's my father. I'm not going to tell you again. And Venom's like, I'm just here for the bad guys, blah, blah, blah. And Darkhawk loses it, just like he did with that guy at the beginning with the gun. And he starts going crazy. And he, just like Ben Reilly, when Ben Reilly's just punching Venom to pieces, that's what Darkhawk does. He punches the living crap out of Venom and then uses a blast on him right at the end there. Boom! And weakens Venom. And once again, right there, defeats him. And he says, he even says, I beat him. I actually beat him legit this time. So the Venom loses. Venom loses the fight against Darkhawk. Darkhawk came in, surprised him, got a couple of good hooks in there, hit him with that beam, and then knocked him the crap out, dude. So then he got him down. The villain of the story, he actually grabs Chris's father, and he's like, look, you're jeopardizing everything. What would you do in this situation? And then the mom comes in with the FBI agent, and they kick the bad guy, knock him down, and they reveal that they've been working together, that they met each other on the plane, coincidentally. Definitely a way for Danny Fingeroth to wrap up this whole storyline and then catch the bad guys. So then you see Chris seeing his parents. They're actually together finally after all this, and now the mom's wondering, well, where's Chris? If Bosn's alive, if you're alive, even though Bosn's brain dead, and he goes, then Chris has to be here. Where is Chris? And meanwhile, Chris is outside trying so hard to turn back into Chris. This is where I think I was like, all right, Danny Fingeroth didn't do great on that, like, button up writing there. But this part, I really like the emotion here, where Chris is trying to turn back into Chris so he can go be with his family. His mom and dad are finally in a room together after all these issues, and he wants to go in there and be with them to let them know he's okay, and he can't. The amulet will not let him transform back out. It's not out of energy, and it won't let him transform back. And at this moment, the techno-organic guy shows up, and he's got, he actually is wearing the amulet, and he tells Chris, look, I was on a mission. Evil Hawk sent me to do this, but once I got the amulet, I wore it myself, and it gave me power over the programming that's in me now, and I wanted to come bring it to you, and I need your help. We need to save the multiverse. And so there are different Darkhawks of different multiverses, or different Hawks from different universes, and I need you to be a part of it and help me stop this big threat that's coming. And so Chris looks back. He's like, but I don't know if I can. He sees his mom and dad, and they're together, and his dad kind of is peering over, like, what's over there? What's looking at me? You kind of get a sense that someone's staring at him. And Chris is like, you know what? My dad always taught me to do things, to do the right thing, and to lead by example. And if there are people in danger, if there's a multiverse of danger, I'm gonna step up. And so he does. And the techno-organic guy, Johnny or whatever, takes him, and they teleport away together onto their next adventure, which we won't really know about. You'll have to find these issues 38 and onward up until Darkhawk ended. You're gonna have to find those on your own, because they don't have Venom in them, so we're not going to cover them on this show. But I still did dig this issue, or these three issues. I thought this was a fun storyline, and you don't get a lot of Eddie Brock in here. Chris does call him Brock a couple times. Obviously, he knows Eddie Brock's secret identity, because it's, in the news and stuff that Brock, did this and became Venom or whatever. So he's not really hiding, per se. So Chris kind of knows who he is and calls him out on it, but you don't really see a lot of Eddie Brock stuff. You don't really get a lot of Venom in here. It's just fighting. That's pretty much all it is. And you do see Venom's, sympathy side. He's like, hey, look, you're clearly a good kid. I don't want to kill you. And even though he's like, all right, I'm going to kill you now. And then when he gets the one up on Chris, he's like, you know what? I'm not going to kill you. And there's a lot of that going back and forth where, Venom's like clearly going to win, and he has a couple opportunities to win. And he just like, you know what? You're fine. I'm going to web you up here. I'm going to go do my thing. I'm going to take down the Seekers with or without your help. Doesn't matter. And then it's not till the end when, you know, Chris sees Venom in proximity of his father and his father's hurt that he's like, all right, none of this. I'm not going to take any chances. Venom's a killer and he's going to see my dad as a bad guy, even though my dad isn't a bad guy in this situation. He's just got in over his head. So I'm going to jump in and take Venom down. And he does, like, full on emotion. So that's where that setup at the beginning where he takes down the guy with the gun, it pays off in the end because that's what he uses, that anger, to take down Venom. So, yeah, pretty fun run. I liked it, and I'm glad I finally got to bring it to your attention. Have you read these issues? If not, let me know down below what you thought of them. And if you have, let me know, do you have a favorite moment that I may have missed or that I did talk about? Let me know down below. We'll continue our conversation, as always, down there. We have two more issues coming up, or two more episodes of this coming up. The next one we're going to talk about is Fusion. It's Cyber Force, Top Cow, crossing over with Avengers and Thunderbolts and Hunter Killer. So it's two Top Cow properties mixing up with Marvel properties. And so yeah, nice three-issue storyline that has the Thunderbolts in them. Check out that cover. And this is the Matt Gargan Venom. So we're going to talk about this in the next issue. We'll call it, you know, I guess Venom versus Cyber Force or something. And then the last episode we're going to do is going to be Avengers Death Trap The Vault. And that'll be the last one for a versus one. And then we'll get back into the Eddie Brock stories like Tooth and Claw and Finale and all those ones and Hunger and Hunted. We'll talk about all those coming up as well. And then we'll get into the Flash Thompson stuff, hopefully by the time, you know, mid-August or late August, as we're knee deep into the Absolute Carnage stuff. And then from then on, I'm probably going to put a stop to the old reviews. And we're just going to cover all the Absolute Carnage stuff. I had a couple people talk to me about it, and they're like, hey, even though you're not digging a lot of the stuff, you know, that Donnie Cates is doing, it is still great to hear you talk about it and you get your feedback on it. And that means a lot to me. I really appreciate it. I'm glad you guys, some of you are okay with hearing an opposing opinion of your own, but I also like hearing yours. So if it does spark conversation, I think that's a great reason to keep doing it. And also there are other writers on these books other than Donnie Cates, like Frank Thierry and Cullen Bunn and a bunch of other talented people that are going to be doing all the time. So I think that's worth covering. So since there's so many books coming out, I think for pretty much the end of August onward, we're probably just going to be talking about Absolute Carnage until the fall. And then right around maybe like October, November, when Absolute Carnage starts wrapping up or after it's wrapped up, we'll dive full on into the Flash Thompson stuff. So for now, I'm just going to try to get through all this Eddie Brock stuff between now and Absolute Carnage. Then we'll dive into Absolute Carnage, and then the fall will be for our friend Flash Thompson. So thank you all. I appreciate the support. I'm sorry I didn't do a lot of episodes last week. I just had to catch up on a lot of stuff. I haven't been feeling well. You know, I just had a rough week, very busy. I'm writing. I'm doing a lot of stuff right now. So I will make it up to you by doing a lot of episodes this week. So I hope you guys stay subscribed and enjoy. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. I'll see you in the future. Peace.